Two speakers sharing a talk. The first our two talks. So the first one is by Abhrajit Laskar, and he's going to talk about flow-induced propulsion in chains made of active colloids.
Good afternoon, everybody. I am really happy to give a talk in front of you in such a glorious way. Everyone is speaking about active colloids. Next half an hour, I'll be talking about flow-induced propulsion in chains of made of active colloids. When I first heard of colloids, the thing came into his mind is that why it is colloids is different from solution. And it is a colloidal solution is a microscopically dispersed insoluble substance suspended in another substance constituting a single homogeneous phase that never settles. That basically distinguishes it from a other solutions. For example, I'll see that in real life, you will have cosmetics, food products, medicine, paints, and so many other variants of it where in daily life we use. And in a experimental front and in theoretical front, we'll see different types of colloids. And most of the time, you'll see micelles, you say macromolecules like protein, you'll see different colloids of different size, shape, and lastly, some patchy colloids. And mostly people are interested in the surface-driven, the assembly made of them and various kind of diffusion flow property as well as rheological property. But in this new colloids meeting, I would like to present the work we are doing on, have been doing for last 4 and 5 years on active colloids. What is active colloids? Active colloids are microscopic bodies that can convert stored energy to mechanical motion and thus impart energy at microscopic level will be called active colloids. What will be the examples? For instance, microbes, which are of micrometer length scales, and as well as recently synthetic catalytic nanomotors, as well as which already Snigdha had told about, is the catalytic nanomotors of various type. So what is the common thing in between is that they impart energy at microscopic level. That's the interesting point. Now, if we compare in the different, the activity happening in different length and time scales, we'll see that it appears in different length scales. For instance, for large ship and human swimmer and so on and so forth. And the thing which is in the x-axis is Reynolds number, which determines how inertial force or inertia is important compared to your viscosity in the solution. And that is given by Reynolds number. And in the colloids, active colloids, which we are interested in, is very low at Reynolds number. Whenever Reynolds number is very low, we can see that inertia is viscosity is dominating over inertial force. So the dynamics we'll be seeing is mostly from viscosity driven. Okay? So let's see the length scale we will be talking about. The molecule length scale is of the nanometers and by atomic is even lesser. And if you go along, we'll see that there is a range of few tens of nanometers to tens of micrometers. That is the range where colloidal dispersion is happening. And beyond that, again, you'll see that sand grains and higher order things where the Brownian motion is not important at all. So in that domain, the self-assembly and other things which is people are looking at and interested in, not they are entropy driven mostly. And so now the question is, what are the time scale is important? If I look at again, the molecular time scale is 10 to the power minus 13, which is not, it's very small compared to anything which we see in real life. Similarly, if we go along, we'll see the momentum diffusion happening and 10 to the power minus 9 seconds. What basically says that if you have a big colloidal particle and around that there are fluid particles, the momentum because of collisions goes that fast into the solution. And if you go along, you'll see that particular regime and much beyond that, you'll see that regime where particle diffusion happening. In this particular talk, I'll be talking about this regime where we'll be really interested in, where it's quasi-inertia free particles. You'll not feel the inertia of the particle as well as it will be driven by the Stokes regime, because from Navier-Stokes, this particular regime will not be important. So why it is important? What is the importance of this study? First off is that it's not inertia driven, so which is counterintuitive to us. Second, there is no external force or torque in these active systems. But still, we see motion happening in different length scale, in collectively and otherwise. And another interesting thing is many-body hydrodynamic interaction. And we know from mathematical background that even three-body dynamics is not completely solved. So forget about many-body. Thirdly, there is the instantaneity of Stokes law. That basically says if there is a momentum infusion at that one point, that will diffuse instantly all over the fluid. And fourth is technological application. In different microfluidic device and others, you'll see that application happening. So let's think of a, like as a physicist, we always think of a spherical cow approximation. Similarly, here also we are comparing that, let's think of a sphere which is moving in a viscous fluid. And Newton's law should be held there. And so that is the Newton's law on surface of the particle. Now in active fluids, there is, first we said that it's low Reynolds number, so there is no inertia, okay? And as there is no external force or torque, there is no force, no torque. So these two conditions has to be satisfied first. So how will we calculate the stress on the particle that should be given by the fluid flow or Stokes equation, which is first equation is saying the incompressibility of the fluid, and second equation says what is the hydrostatic force and what is the velocity force, velocity, the stress due to velocity gradient on the particle. Now, this should be satisfied by the boundary condition on the surface of the particle. So on the surface of the particle, first term is the translational velocity, then rotational velocity, along with a active slip. What is this active slip? If you, to motivate you to talk about active slip, let's go back to the experiment. In an electrophoretic motion or any kind of phoretic motion, you will see that next to the particle, they forms a very small layer of a other particles or a gradient, which very goes to a saturation limit after a some length scale. This extra part is the layer, active double layer. And here after that, the velocity of the particle, you can define. Even in a ciliary motion, you will see that thing, you can consider a spherical body, and along with that, there is a small ciliary layer, after which you can say that there is a velocity given there. In all these cases, we can say that ideal active particle can be given by your net translation velocity, angular velocity, along with a surface velocity, which is coming purely because of active motion happening in that double layer. It might be because of phoretic motions, it might be from ciliary motion, or maybe some other different mechanism can be there. Now the question is, if I know the Stokes equation and boundary condition, we can write it in terms of boundary integral formula equation. What it basically says that at the fluid, we can calculate the velocity at fluid flow at some point r by the surface density given on top of every spherical surface, by Fj, the force, as well as the surface velocity given on the surface in terms of this. Now the importance is that, and with the kernels, of course, first one is Green's function, and second one is the stress kernel. And now what we'll do, we'll expand that these two sources on top of tensorial spherical harmonics on the surface of the particle. The moment you will do so, you can write this integral equation in summation forms. This integral equation in summation of different irreducible forms. And if you do the maths, you'll get into the equations where you can say that what is the propulsion velocity because of your classical mobility times force, mobility times torque, along with newly found propulsion matrix time active velocity or active propulsion on the surface. Along with this is the term which responsible for self-propulsion of the body. And this will take care of the hydrodynamics due to active motion. Now, similarly, you can ask the question, and the interesting thing is that it is how it is different from what Snigdha is doing, is that the moment you will take care of Green function way, you can take care of fluid degrees of motion. So from 3D 3n number of particles, you can go to 2D surfaces. and the integration will be so computationally it is very efficient and much faster than any CFD techniques you can you'll come across, because you have to integrate out all the fluid degrees of motion in one case but not in our case. So we can do hundreds of thousands of particles through this mean in a finite time. So similarly, we can ask the question, what is the flow by these flows, because of this active flow or passive flow happening? If you see, the first term is because when a colloidal particle is sedimenting, it forms this kind of structure. Similarly, if I say some other plots, you'll see. Now the question is whether it will explain the experiments or not. To see that, this is a theory what is giving, and in a recent experiment, they have shown that a ball box, which is a bottom-heavy bacteria, when it swims through, then this is a flow field around that particle, and you can see the match happening. Similarly, when an E. coli moves in a fluid, they will produce similar kind of flow field far apart from the particle. You can see that the flow is coming from this direction and going these two directions. Similarly, if the flow is coming through this direction and going through this direction. But the one point of notice is that only this motion cannot lead to a self-propulsion, because nowhere the symmetry of the flow is breaking, right? So to do so, you can either add a passive particle, like the work Snigdha was talking about, and similarly, in you will see that similar kind of match with the experiment that it is happening. Similarly, another thing you can do, you can think of next multiple, which is responsible for potential dipole. It has a particular direction of directionality in it, and it can propel in that particular directions. And you can see in an experimental model from Goldstein lab that the particle is moving that direction with a flow field along with it. Okay, good. Now we'll talk about if I have this this apolar particles which cannot move by himself, the collection of these particles. Now the moment you keep them in a line, and let's see that what hydrodynamics can do to this, you'll see that with a little perturbation, transverse perturbation, the flow actually try to destabilize the perturbation, increase the perturbation more and more, and leads to a motion which is not very common in equilibrium phenomena. To give you a overview of that, if you have a extensile dipole, you'll see that this configuration are unstable, this and this. But on the other hand, if you have a contractile dipoles, they will have a much more rigidity than the extensile. So in this case, the linear chain would be stabilized, but in this case, nonlinear or curvature will be increased by the hydrodynamic flow feedback into the loop. To put it into, so to study that more in more detail, what we did is that put in a simple spring model and make these beads active. They are non-motile but active mode, and took the only the first wristlet, which goes 1 by r square in long range. So the equation of motion you can write in terms of first term is saying that what is the self term, second term saying about the hydrodynamic interaction of the basic potentials of bond and the spring potential, as well as the bending elasticity. And the third term is responsible for your fluid it generates, or the fluid flow it generates, it's responsible for that. Now the moment you'll get, so you can write the one parameter, dimensionless parameter group, activity number in terms of the length of the polymer, the strength of the activity S naught, and the bending elasticity kappa, and define a activity number. Now onwards, whatever I'll study in this activity number parameter space instead of any of activity kappa or L. So what we see that if you have a initial condition with some perturbation in it, and you turn on the activity, and you'll see that this biomimetic motion start appearing, and you'll see that happening with time, and it's completely, there is no external force or no external torque, but still you'll get this biomimetic motions in detail. Now, what happens if that, if you clamp this guy in one end of it and try to ask the question that if you increasing the activity number from zero onwards, so initially the linear chain will expect to be stable, that is so. But after a certain critical activity number, you will see that the linear chain is not stable anymore and it will form a helical-like beating motion. It starts from, it is the steady state motion which I am showing here. It forms a helical tail and it moves in a big circle and it's going on and on. The reason it's not going out of the plane is because there is no noise here. If you put noise here, I'll expect that similar kind of motions, but with the fluctuation of the orbit itself a bit. Now, if you increase the activity more, you will see that from a three-dimensional motion, it restricts itself to a two-dimensional motion and it starts beating like a sperm tail. It when it goes in swimming, it does only a planar beating and moves forward. The reason is that in that particular activity domain, the 3D motion of or helical beating motion is stable. The reason is the energy minimization is maximum at the level by the 3D motion, not by the 2D planar motion. Now, if we look at the linear stability analysis of the stability matrix, we'll see that there in the with the presence of hydrodynamics, initially the linear state is stable. But as you increase the activity is here it's scaled with the length which is coming into the picture, is actually cross the zero and become unstable. And so here you will see that all kind of motion is happening, and below which you will see that linear chain is very stable. Similarly, when you cut off the hydrodynamics, you will see that no such motion is happening and there is no length scale involving into the system as well. So the moral of the thing is that hydrodynamics is very much essential to get any this kind of biomimetic motions in non-motile active chains. Now, as we said earlier, that you can break the symmetry by one way of is that putting potential dipole, or you can break it by putting passive colloids next to a active colloid, but which was not motile earlier, start moving in a particular direction because it breaks the symmetry and it will start moving. Similarly, if it is a extensile is this case, and in the contractile case, it will move into the other direction. Similarly, you can ask the question, if you have a slender filament and put on top of that one active colloid, and again you turn on the activity slowly, initially you will see that the linear chain is very stable, and with time it forms again the helical kind of movement, and it is actually propelling in one direction, which I couldn't able to show it in a good way in a three-dimensional movie. And similarly, if you increase the activity more, it again comes back to the two-dimensional stable state, and it starts propelling in a particular direction with a beating-like state. So if I ask the activity, initially it is propelling in one direction, but it doesn't change in its shape. But along as you increase the activity, it starts changing the shape conformation of the body itself, and thus the speed of the filament or the load of the filament. As you go along, it will see these parts here. Now I'll talk about the summary of this. The correct microscopic description of active particles is given in this, and this theory can be used to study higher order objects like filaments and maybe membranes later on. This theory can be applied to simple geometries and to study rheological and flow properties from this particulate model. And non-equilibrium active flow can break symmetry and thus can lead to motion. It highlights the importance of many-body hydrodynamic interaction of active particles. And thirdly, the biomimetic motion observed in active filaments can be used for cargo transport in microfluidic environment as an efficient, and maybe when it is forming the beating state, it can be used as an efficient stirrer or various technological application. I want to acknowledge my supervisor for supervision, Sunil for fruitful discussions, and friends and colleagues who helped me in different discussions. And lastly, thank you. questions.